Two chairs there. You need more than three?
Hope not.
There's like a broken one over here, but it doesn't have a back, and there's this chair here too.
Okay, so this should be good.
Thank you for helping.
Thank you so much, yeah.
So just so you can see, this is the.
Okay, so we should sit up here, because I know Jerry's out of town, and so is.
Brad.
So is John said he wouldn't be able to make it.
Yeah, John Shees, the other guy.
Okay.
He's having a the entire fifth grade of his daughter's school is coming to his house to do a such a spooky house. So this is the plan for most.
Okay.
So this is the current fence, and this used to be a brick fence, brick wall, excuse me, before the earthquake. So it's been like this for 20 years. Like this is, and see how it's all falling apart here? And this is still the broken fence there.
Yeah, but so, we don't have anything to do with that because whether or not the tower was going in, that fence would.
What I'm trying to show is what kind of a neighbor they've been.
Oh.
Do you understand? Like.
Yeah, but we can't.
I understand. I'm just saying, like, just so that you can see, this is what was supposed to be like a 6-month thing. And over here, this fence over here is being held up with pile, with like wood. And that's the other place
here.
That
might be my old property before after the earthquake.
Right, right. Which is fine for 6 months or a year, even 2 years, you know what I mean? But that's been the...
Hey!
Hi, how's
Hi.
It going?
Maria, come
good,
take a seat.
Good,
this is my stupid room.
I know!
We should be getting
rid of
the library, getting rid
of the library. Hey, Richard.
Saturday.
Yeah, I'm going to be playing Saturday.
I know you want to get on.
Okay.
You have a time where you can't play.
Okay. Well, I have going to UCLA games. So.
Is this something you want?
No.
These are some pictures. I took this morning.
I can share with Eric. That's okay.
I have three copies. This is the fence between our street and the church. And this is, I just want you guys to understand why we don't hold much weight when they say we'll do this. Because this has been for 20 years. This has been since the Northridge earthquake. And there used to be a brick wall here that came down during the earthquake.
Yeah,
and so you can see there's part of it there. And so they put up that fence, I guess, temporarily 20
Jeff
years ago.
Do you have the copy, actually?
Yeah. Okay. I might need to give one to Wally if he comes in.
I think he's there.
Okay, great.
These are just pictures of the current fence.
Okay.
So I just was kind of showing that was since that's been 20 years since.
Anybody need an agenda?
Just so people know.
I've got some thoughts with you. I'll talk about it.
How are you doing?
I'm trying to prevent the location.
Yeah, we're good.
Perfect.
Yeah,
hey,
we're good.
Yeah. I ordered a few drinks. Let me know when you get here. I'll come drink all of them.
Anyone else need an agenda? Yeah, he sent me an email saying he wouldn't be able to make it. Yeah. Oops, I forgot.
protected. I know.
Meeting order. It is now 6:48. Okay, I'm going to call a roll. Gary Askew is absent. He's excused. He's away on a meeting. I'm here. Cindy Wu is here. Maria Fisk is here. And John Stamos. Salido said that he wouldn't be able to make it. So we do have a quorum. Okay. At this time, is there any public comment on non-agendized items? Yes, Mr. Kuzi.
Let you know that even after the regular meeting agenda not being posted in compliance with all the rules and regulations, that tonight's meeting agenda was not posted on the website a minimum of 24 hours in advance. This is a violation of the Dunn Resolution dated 2014-01.1. The screenshot of the Planning and Land Use Committee was not on the Renata Hill South website as of 8 a.m. today, this morning, which is not 24 hours in advance. The agenda email was not delivered by ENS today, suggesting this DLE meeting agenda was not submitted to the ENS system a minimum of 24 hours in advance. This meeting should be canceled immediately for failure to comply with the agenda posting requirements and subsequently the G Renata Hill South Neighborhood Council bylaws. The meeting is continued and motions made are subject to being overturned. I have quoted the resolution stating the posting requirements and the fact that those posting requirements are part of the neighborhood bylaws, and a copy of the screenshot is attached. It's a copy for the public.
I received this email this morning, talked to our attorney, and he said that everything that it was posted on our bylaws, our Renata Hill South Neighborhood Council postings in accordance. You just didn't see it because Aaron said that he just thought it was a duplicate and he just put it in with the other one. So it was noted on the agenda and it was sent to our attorney who has confirmed it. Also, that just because the ENS doesn't post it on time, as long as we get it to them within a certain time, they said that that was just fine. So the meeting will continue as noted in the agenda. You may continue your complaint with our attorney, which is your right. Thank you. Any other public comment? Seeing none, let's get down to the old business update. Appeal of proposed cell tower at 10341 North Whitley Avenue. Major review issues raised by applicant in opposition to the proposed wireless telecommunication facilities by Verizon Wireless. Action of the committee may be included and rescinded, amended proposition taken by prior meeting. Okay, I see that our synergy representative is here. You have materials you'd like to hand out. Okay.
Mr. Guzman, would you like that?
Oh, sure.
You want?
at a time and saw a copy for my own. You guys really want to?
Yeah, I've got some small ones, yeah.
Thank you for having me here again.
No,
I appreciate that. I'd like to start off by thanking Jill and particularly John Sheese, who's not here, who I, the church, myself, neighborhood, council district's office, we had a sit-down meeting at the church, discussed concerns that Mr. Sheese was pulling together from many of the people who were opposed to the project, including Jill's comments. Him not speaking for Jill, Jill's here to speak on her own behalf. We made several revisions and changes to the proposed design, taking into consideration all those comments that came out of that meeting. What we did was we relocated the tree from the back of the property to the front of the property.
Can we just call it not a tree, because it's not a tree?
Some modifying is the technical term of it. Yeah. And the equipment is placed towards the front of the property adjacent to an existing fence line, in line with the front fence line and running along the northern side of the fence line. So that's where the new equipment location is placed. It's 30 feet by 15 feet of dimensions. The height of the tree is unchanged. The look and design of the tree is unchanged. Just the basic location is where that is. There's one item that we did not meet to the full satisfaction of John and Jill, which is they requested that the fence along the northwest portion of the property, that is kind of the barrier between where the folks' homes are and where the dead grass is on the church property. They asked for a block wall to be placed there. We came back with a proposal of planting crawling vines. They found that not acceptable. So that may be a recommendation of condition of approval that you have to go up. Having that recommendation of approval gives me further backing when I go back to Verizon and re-request doing the block wall versus just the landscaping. So it would be block wall in lieu of landscaping.
Now, as I understand it, this fence actually belongs to the property owner?
It belongs to the church.
Okay.
There actually, years ago, there had been a block wall there previously, but it had fallen down during one of the past earthquakes. So we're actually would be restoring a wall that was previously there.
And what street is this? Is this fence is along?
It's along
Hiawatha. It's along
Hiawatha? It's right at the intersection corner.
It's right here. Like number
okay.
Three on the.
Oh, okay. With the small, yeah, okay.
First, tonight to ask for your recommendation of support of our project moving forward. There was one other issue that was raised where Jill and I were talking last night. I asked if she would be willing to provide a letter of support for the project now that where we have come if Verizon switches to the block wall. And the last item from her discussion from last night is she wants some kind of backing, substantial backing, that no further co-locations will come on this property. The code kind of requires co-location. What I do as a site acquisition agent to find a location to put a cell tower, first thing I do is I do look for existing cell towers. But what I then do is I pull the records for the hearings and everything that's been entered in the record to see how I'm going to proceed. If the neighborhood council recommends that, or states very clearly that we would not support any future co-locations at this property, it could be entered into the record for a person like myself who goes in to do the research so I can visually see that. What that does is it gives me backing to go put up my own tower for my own separate company in another location. It's far less expensive lease-wise and construction-wise for a carrier to go put in their own Colorado public base. So that actually gives me an incentive to find a new location or other location to go. I'm also going to the church. I haven't been able to have a conversation yet. I plan on doing that tomorrow after I get any comments from the public from today to see if they would be willing to do something to have some guarantee put in place that they would not entertain any other lease offers for any future co-locators. And those are the discussions we've had so far and where we're at.
What rights do we have that we can actually make that?
You know, I would recommend you talk to Brian O, the Council District's office. I don't think you have the authority to deny it. But what you do is you have the ability to voice your stern, clear position that you would not support any future locations. What that does is give me support to not co-locate, me being if I was a new carrier coming along, to not co-locate on this pole, giving me the ability to go someplace else. Further, if the church is going to do something, I'm not sure how we would be able to do this yet, of some kind of agreement where they would not lease to any future co-locators, that rules it out automatically. So if the church isn't willing to lease any further property, and after all of the opposition and concerns, I don't know where they're at with that, but it's a conversation I need to have, and I promised Joe that I would have with the church and see what we can do about that on that side. And that would actually go with that.
So the current one is supposed to be 45 feet.
The proposed, yes.
Right. So then what happens if, because right now the original, the other one was supposed to be 45 feet, and then quickly they put on the second carrier on that one. So what's to keep this one from going up to 65 feet soon?
Soon?
Well, whenever. Like, can this one be capped at 45 feet so that we can't have...
Actually, per code, we're required to build a foundation that would support a future co-locator. On that, the pole itself, usually they end up either having to do a full extension or a replacement, actual replacement of the pole with a taller pole to meet the additional height. The code allows for an additional 15 feet to accommodate a future co-locator. But you can't, the Area Planning Commission and the ruling bodies of the DA cannot take into consideration a what if. They have to go by what is at face value and before them at the time. So that's something that they really can't, they can't consider, you know, we're proposing a 45 foot tree, but we really want to look at what this would be for a 60 foot tree. We're not going with a 60 foot tree, we're going with a 45 foot tree. So on the side of the city, I don't think they can do that. You're welcome to talk to the planning department, the council district's office. I think they're going to say pretty much what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is, what you can do is you can give the people like me who do my job a notice and heads up that, hey, hands off, we don't want you here, don't come here. That gives them all the incentive to not go there and go someplace else because it is cheaper. It's less expensive rent-wise. It's less expensive construction-wise to do that. So that's my suggestion. And as I mentioned, I'll go back to the church and talk.
So would the church be willing to say that they would not put an additional 15 feet on that?
I'm going to have that conversation tomorrow.
Okay.
And my guess is we'll talk about it on Sunday.
The thing about it is, you cannot speak for a third party.
Right. And we invited the pastor here.
Yeah. And what's
with the pastor was actually, yes, that's another fair statement. The pastor was here yesterday. He came and talked to you, and he was told that the meeting was changed to today. And I let you guys know yesterday that the pastor did come by. He was willing to be here yesterday. He wasn't able to make it.
Okay. I was here until about 7 last night.
Yeah. Gentleman
with gray hair didn't show up and come
on. No, I came. I met him until 7:40, right?
Oh, really?
Yeah,
oh,
he was in the parking lot with me when Jerry called me.
Okay, well, just to let you know, Marie and I met around 7:15.
Mm-hmm. And he actually told me he thinks Jill's sitting next to a gentleman sitting outside.
Okay,
so he saw you guys here.
But he didn't introduce himself.
Okay, yeah, I wish he had introduced himself.
That
would
have been nice.
I'll make sure he's, or I will request that he's here for the full neighborhood council.
Okay.
He has no qualms about
that. Yeah, because I don't
know.
He's told me
he wants to be here for the full neighborhood council. He wanted to be here for this. He came yesterday, it was canceled. So
it's kind of inconvenient for us because it's our job to try and flush these things out
before
so when we make
board.
Our yeah, before we go to the board, and I don't want to speak for somebody who's not here, because I don't represent them. I don't know what they're saying. I don't know what they're thinking. And then when he comes to the board meeting, yeah, I have no idea what he's going to say, or as he represents his church and what their thinking is about these cell towers.
And then he's not even, the board is who does the final voice, right? So even if the pastor recommends something, it still has to go before the board?
I think he's got a lot of support.
Okay. So,
but yes, you cannot make a decision unilaterally. That's true.
That's something we can't do either. We can't unilaterally make a decision.
But what you can do is you can make a recommendation based on conditions. And that condition being that you very clearly state that you want no future co-locators at the property. That's something you can do, and you can make your voice loud there.
But also, I think, you know, without having him here, maybe we need to make an agreement today based on his future recommendation, his input.
So we should wait for the next meeting?
I don't know.
No, we'll have to take this up at our next board meeting, because I'm going to have to give a report to them to put on the agenda, because our president is already asking for agenda items. Mm-hmm. And so whatever we do tonight, it's going to go before the whole neighborhood council next Thursday.
Okay.
So, and I can't put any recommendation down without the most important party here, the property owner.
Right.
Well, I don't understand that, why you can't do that.
Because if he says something different than somebody else says, and it comes back to us, then we have egg on our face because we did not consult with that gentleman. And
But the decision before you that you have to determine and that you are looking at is based on the project before you, not on what could possibly happen in the future.
Well, she's asking for a resolution as to no others. And I'm saying that he could come along and say, I will rent to anybody I want, whenever I want, if they've got the right amount of cash. And that's his right. And so everything that we do, this is great, but it's still speculative.
My point is, even if he said that, it shouldn't weigh into the decision factor, because you have to base the project based on the project in front of you, not what could happen in a year or 10 years from now.
Well, I think you're wrong, because I think we need to get input from all parties involved, and being a fair and just kind of a situation here, we need to hear from the parties themselves. You know, we can't just be making a decision in a vacuum. What we could do is make the recommendation, you know, based on what we're hearing today, based on input and our suggestions, followed up with a final decision from the pastor.
And our stakeholders here were very upset.
What I was trying to do was find a workaround with where you could make a decision based on the condition of.
What I'm hearing from Eric
is that you can't make a decision regardless, is what I was hearing.
Cindy? So in my past experience, I know that when you came in front of the Plum Committee before, you know, that we talked about having notices sent out. And we did, you know, have an approval based on a condition, but that it didn't work out that way, because when it actually got to a third party, it became an approval without any conditions. So I think now we're just a little bit more hesitant. And my question, and so there was some issues with whether the neighbors received notices or not about the cell towers being put up.
I have the notification package. I offered it to Jerry to offer it up to you guys if you guys wanted it and piece it out. I'm happy to turn that over. You guys can take a look at it and see who was and who wasn't. I've got no problem handing over to Jill.
And also, I gave you guys in my appeal all of the testimonials from John Schuetz didn't receive it. And also,
John's on the mailing list. I looked at it.
Okay, well, I'm just letting you know he didn't. And also, the neighbor not right there where the fence is, but the one next to it, they said that they didn't receive it.
Well, a lot of times what happens is a lot of us get a lot of mail, and we're busy in our daily lives, and we get, and the notice is basically one sheet of paper folded and stapled most of the time. Mm-hmm. A lot of times people look at it and they toss it.
Yeah.
And that happens a lot.
I understand
the concern behind it. Right. I understand the concern, right?
So because we ended up with egg on our face when these stakeholders came forward and said we hadn't been notified, and they were very upset. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, out of an abundance of caution, we don't want to repeat that situation. Jill and her friends and neighbors.
And they would have come if we asked them. We're trying to just get to the nuts and bolts. That's why everybody's willing to come. We're just trying to get things ironed out. But, you know, they're happy to come if we need them to come.
So are you, okay, so are you feeling comfortable? Okay, because we also need a consensus from you all.
Yeah. Right. We still don't want this tower, okay? We still don't want it. We may not have a choice. So we're kind of dealing with the lesser of two evils.
Understood.
Okay, huh?
I understand.
Still don't want it because I'll let you know when I went to Van Nuys on July 1st, when the gentleman made his oral decision, part of his argument was there's already one there. Okay? That was a big part of it. And then when we asked about other alternatives, like the Smart and Final site, it was told by the people that were there that that was not an option. Later on, we found out that it was. It's just that it's a very expensive option. So that one could have been an option. It just was an expensive option.
That's absolutely not true. It has absolutely nothing to do with cost. It's far cheaper for Verizon to actually go. It's actually not far cheaper. There's no difference in cost. It's a bold place in the ground.
Can I finish? Because I let you finish. Is that okay?
Fair enough. I apologize.
Okay. So I'm just letting you know, the fact that one was there and that we didn't fight the first one, whatever, 10 or more years ago, we should have fought it then, okay? So we didn't. We're like, okay, we're cool. We're a neighbor. And so then that was what got us very concerned, was the fact that the second one, that was part of the decision-making process. There's already one there. So now, if we allow a second one, what's going to keep it from being a cell tower farm? And so that's where I still don't want it. I still don't support it. If I can get concrete, cannot be fought in court, that it's not going to get another co-locator and that there's not going to be a third tower there, if I can get that, and I don't know what that is. I don't know if it's Brian O needs to bring a resolution in front of the city council. I don't know. To me, as a layperson who doesn't know the law, it would make sense to me as part of the conditional use permit that that could be. But I don't know the law, so I'm just talking as a logical social studies teacher. That to me, because that's a conditional use permit. I would think that if there's no more, because otherwise, if I write a letter of support, right, this can be totally used against us and for a third one. Well, they supported the second one. So I'm saying, if I can get concrete written support, and I don't know what that looks like. I don't know if it's a letter that's notarized by the board and put onto the title as a contingency of the title. I don't know what that is. And see, that's why I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's like the city council has to pass an ordinance. I don't know if it's a letter from the board that gets, you know, tied into the title. I don't know. These are just things I don't know. I don't know. But by going on just good faith, I'm just asking you as a neighbor. Okay, the Northridge earthquake was 20 years ago. Okay, we used to have a block wall there, so we didn't see everything in the church. It came down. Mr. Sheese, not John, and just so you know, John Sheese would be here, but for like 3 months he's been planning with his daughter's school that he has a big spooky house in his house. The whole fifth grade is going there tonight. So we couldn't postpone it. I was supposed to be tutoring tonight. I put that off because, you know, I won't do that. But I'm just letting you know that if you can look at just the, I'm just asking you to look at what kind of neighbor the church has been. Just so you know, the pastor has never called me, and I've left several messages. Now, I've heard he thinks I'm an angry woman, and maybe he doesn't want to deal with me. So that's his right. But I'm just asking as a neighbor, to look at that fence, you can still see there's broken bricks, right, front or broken cement blocks. And then it's a hurricane fence that we understood would be temporary, and 20 years later, it's still there. And so the other fence on the other side, which he shares with a neighbor, so maybe that person needs to contribute money, he's dead. He's an elderly man who died a couple years ago. That one is still being held up with like pylons or whatever, some kind of, I don't know, wood or something. I don't know what that term is. So that has been there for 20 years. So now they're going to put another 20 by 25 brick structure there that we will see, and a 45-foot tower, and then possibly another 15 feet. So we're trying to be neighbors. We're like, okay, if you can put it back the way it was 20 years ago, and if you can give us assurance that there's not going to be another one, because if we say we support it, then we feel that it's going to be used to bite us to put a third one on. And so I think that we've more than bent over backwards in terms of we've already allowed one that wasn't being taken care of. Interestingly, right after that first meeting where we showed up, within about 2 weeks, they fixed it. So maybe it's been planned for several years. I don't know. It's interesting. The timing was interesting, but I can't suppose things. I'll just say right after that first meeting when everybody came, that was when they fixed it. You know, so I don't know, but if you can look at the church, it's not kept up well. And there's two things. It can be the budget of the church, but we don't know how much money the church is making a month off of this, which I think would be good information to have. So the church is going to be making a lot more additional money, and we aren't getting anything out of this. Do you understand? What are we getting out of this? And that's where I really feel as neighbors, we've more than been friendly to this church. You know, like I said, he never contacted me, even on the last day of vacation at 6 o'clock. I was woken up in the morning last day, you know, with that stuff. And I went over to the church, and the people, you know, 6:15, it took them 45 minutes to stop. And it's just like, that's all I'm just saying is that we're not being, I really feel that as a neighborhood, we've kind of like, yeah, we don't want it right next to where, you saw that lady who was here at the plum meeting, whatever, 2 months ago?
Yes.
It's going to be right outside her door. She didn't want that. I mean, I don't think that's unreasonable. So we still don't want it, but if we have to have it, I think it's completely reasonable that they don't add in 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, another 15 feet to look at. And a dangerous precedent that this becomes, you know, an industrial area. It's a neighborhood. We just have the streets resurfaced. It looks nice. And, you know, we just want our neighborhood. And like you said, the gentleman right next to it, Mr. Sheese, I still call him that because I've known him since I was 6. He's been there for 50 years. John's been there close to 10 years. I've been there for 40 years. All the people along Hiawatha Street are all original homeowners except for one house just sold last year. The other people before that have been 30 years since the house has been sold. So, I mean, I don't think that we're being unreasonable one bit. I mean, if this was your neighborhood, what would you want? Would you want
we're battling another one.
We understand.
We understand, too.
I can't go by the good faith of the church because I haven't seen any good faith of the church. I look at the fence. That, to me, is symbolic of the neighborliness. So, you know, if I can have concrete written assurance that can't be unwritten by a lawsuit by the church.
You know, I gotta stop you right there, yeah. Because actually, it's not really up to the city, it's up to the state. The regulations actually come down from the state because this is a federal situation, because it deals with telecommunications. That's FCC. Mm-hmm. And this, anything the city could say, it could be overridden by
right.
the state. And that's something
saying,
we found out.
If we quote unquote agree to it, we're afraid that that's going to be used against us because the first one was used against us because we didn't fight it.
That may be true, but all I can tell you is that there's no way that we can promise you that it would be concrete.
I'm just saying if the church writes a letter.
It doesn't make any difference if the President of the United States came down and wrote a letter. It could be overwritten. Well, all I'm saying is we have tried.
Then why would we support a tower?
I'm not saying that you have to support a tower. I'm not saying that you have to support this tower at all. What you have to say to us is very important to us, but what you're asking is for us to, we're advisory.
Right.
We, and believe me, as advisory, we could be overridden easily. But I can tell you this, because it's federal, they can override anything that the city says. So for you to ask for something that's absolutely concrete, I don't think that exists. Right. I wish it did.
Right. That might be a good point, yeah.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is that why would I write a letter of support?
You do not have to, please.
Right, but I appreciate that Wally has decided to move it, but I appreciate that. We really do. But I'm just saying, everything that I'm hearing is, well, we have to talk about now, not in the future. Well, I'm gonna live there for a long time. So I kinda need to think about the future in terms of, is this guy just gonna just sell it, you know, keep selling it? And so, because for him, the church is only open a few hours a week. Their hours are very limited. They don't even have the preschool there all the time. So he might be there, you know, 10 hours a week. That's his place of business. But we live there.
Yeah, but so, the only thing I'm trying to tell you is mm-hmm. that what you're asking for mm-hmm. is well out of our
preview. I'm not asking you. I'm just saying Wally has asked for a letter of support.
I'm going to tell you something. Yeah. Wally would be lying to you if he could absolutely guarantee, because he does not know what the future will hold, what kind of inventions, what kind of telecommunications, where it's going to go. He's basically installs those towers for these companies.
He makes money by installing them. Yeah. We have to remember that. Yeah.
So for me, I definitely understand what you're saying. And I think for me, I am okay with at least, you know, voice our opinion on behalf of you, mm-hmm. because I think it just holds more weight. Mm-hmm. You know, and I definitely understand that, you know, whatever we decide, it could be overwritten and all that. But I've seen neighborhood councils who are very powerful, and whatever's being decided are, you know, are weighted by what neighborhood council says. So I'm okay with that. I'm curious that you mentioned you're going to reach out to the pastor tomorrow, but you knew we were having the meeting today. So I'm just curious, how come? Did you have a chance to reach out to him today? No. Did you have a chance to reach out to him today?
I did not.
Okay. Is there any particular reason why you decided to do it tomorrow versus today?
I don't know what's going to come out of this meeting, and I want to have a one substantial meeting with the pastor to go back to the trustees, because I don't know what's going to come out of you folks. So I don't want to. I'm not looking to piecemeal everything. I'm trying to get everything incorporated to talk about, have a fruitful discussion on everything.
Okay, let me make a comment. I think we can't make a decision unless we have more concrete information from you. Jill, I think from you, we would like something a little more concrete in writing, perhaps with the neighbor signatures, that you're all in one in unison with this kind of a thing.
Okay? If we have the wall and assurance that this is that.
That kind of a thing, okay. Whatever you guys want, I think we need this in writing, and you know, with signatures or whatever, just, you know, so we have more of a fair representation.
Okay, that's fair.
You know, what Wally is saying is only a good thing. We can make all the recommendations we want, but you know, Verizon can say, well, we'll do this on good faith. You know, whether that contract will be binding, highly unlikely. It's just verbal, and it's not really something that the city can stand, you know, behind as a conditional use permit. There's nothing that we really have that would be hard for that could come against and regulate that. So we have to keep that in mind. I'm very concerned that the pastor has not come in, that the church is blighted to begin with, that there's repairs that need to be done, that this has not been, in my opinion, probably from what I'm hearing, an opinion that he's not the most best neighbor, perhaps.
Not forthcoming.
Why is the board member? I understand that he didn't have a lot of conversations with him with Jill. I am the representative for the project. I'm supposed to be the person fielding these calls and talking to everybody, which I have been doing. Okay. And secondly, when John was not appointed or elected to speak for everybody and talk to that, there have been conversations. There's been meetings at the church, sit down with the council district's office, with John's fiance, with people there. So there have been conversations.
But they haven't come to us. We don't hear that.
And again, I met the pastor in the church parking lot last night. He was the one that told me that the meeting was postponed. He told me there were two people sitting there, and he thinks that one of those might
might be Jill. And I said, okay, I'm going to go over and talk to him because I want them to know that I showed up and it just not show up. So I came over and I talked to you guys. And I mentioned as soon as I came over there, I just saw the pastor on the parking lot. So I don't want the pastor being painted unfairly.
No, we're not painting him unfairly. What we're just saying is
that there's a lot of negative connotations there, and I feel like I have to say something.
Okay, but from the looks of the property, okay. So be that as it may, let's just kind of think about this for a moment. I don't think we can, maybe, we need more information before we can make a recommendation of any kind. Because, you know, we're right now. We don't have the pastor's input. We don't have the board's input. We don't have anything concrete from the neighbors as well. And I think in the future, we need to come back and we need to hash this out. I think we need to ask CD12 a few more questions about what we can do that would be a little more binding from our perspective. And let's maybe kind of, okay, because we need more information. I need to know.
Yeah, that's our problem because we got too many people who say they're speaking for other people.
I can't do anything with that.
We're
trying to get focused is basically what we're trying
and
to
we're,
do.
We're yeah. still, and, you know, the cancellation of the meeting had nothing to do with us. We were going to be here. It was just a technicality. Sorry about that. I think that threw kind of a wrench in the works, unfortunately. But we're trying to do our best with this as well. You know, we're under a little bit of a challenge as well. Because, you know, because last night, if the pastor would have been here, this would have been a lot easier.
I'm really sorry about you, and I know you say you represent, but we need to see those people.
Oh, we would have had them here.
Yeah.
I wanted to have them here, but John and I talked, and we were trying to get more focused.
But Joe, can I recommend to you that, you know, when you get together with a pastor or whatever, that you all put something in writing to us, you know, with a signature?
Yeah, because then we can take that and say, okay, now we got something in front of us.
Right. Especially if we could get a letter from the board stating that they are not planning to go up the additional 15 feet and they're not planning to have anything else built there, do you know how easy that would be to go to the neighbors and go, look, you know what, we don't want it. We hate it. We don't want it.
I don't know if those guarantees would be necessary.
You can't.
No, but I'm just saying, will be good.
I understand, but I don't want people go off and say certain things that and make it sound like it's a done deal. It's a promise. Right. We can't keep that.
If I can get that from the church, that would be good faith towards us in terms of, you know what, if it's in writing, then if we could get that and if I could take that to my neighbors, then I know they would sign off on it. If we can get the brick wall and written assurance from the church in writing, from the board, notarized, or however that works, then that would be very easy.
Yeah.
So, but it just seems difficult to support something when it may be another 15 feet, there may be a brick wall, and there may be another one in a year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. So if we can get that from the church, that would be really meaningful.
I think something like that would be, you know, a little bit helpful, but in writing also. Mm-hmm. And it's a monopine, right? It's going to have pine needles.
Now the original one there, that's going to be refurbished?
It's already done.
It's all okay. That's already
that's
done.
Sure.
I think I explained.
I remember you talked to us about it.
We had a plumb meeting at two of the neighborhood council meetings. AT&T built the original pole. T-Mobile came on as a co-locator. AT&T was the owner of the pole. AT&T sold a majority of their towers, just like T-Mobile did, to a company called Crown Castle. There was a transference. Before that transference happened, the pastor had actually tried to talk to AT&T about them doing something. It fell on deaf ears. My guess is probably because they knew they were selling the tower. They didn't want to have to pay for it. Crown came in, put it, and when he talked to Crown promised that they would do it. They actually did it a lot quicker than I thought they would do it because they're backlogged right now with all the new towers they just acquired to try and make sure that if there's any existing towers that are not conformist, to bring them into conformity is a lot of work to do across the nation on that front. So that's a little bit of the time delay with what happened. It is kind of coincidental it happened at this time, but it had nothing to do with our project and it had nothing to do with me and Verizon. But it has been rebranched and taken care of.
What's your company policy on upkeep of model fines? What's your company policy on upkeep? You know, the branches get blown off, they get...
There should be a condition of approval. I mean, most standard conditions of approval now in the city are to maintain the existing tree branch density. And that's your protection, because if that is not maintained, then it falls into disrepair. The city can gain the CUP and the tower's got to go. So that's
a very important.
That's the protection.
That's a very important.
I have a couple questions for you. So sure. Your job, your company, all you do is just locate them. That's your job. You're kind of like a. You call yourself a locator. So your only job is to find the spots where phone companies can go in, correct? And then once you find them, you get them approved, then the next thing you do is you find the next location. That's your job.
My job is much more substantial than that.
Right, but you don't do any of the maintenance, because after that, your job is pass it on to Verizon. Verizon has their own crew, their own people to come in and install it, because, Synergy is just an outsourcer.
We are the applicant representative for Verizon.
Right. I mean, you're approved by them as a vendor
to locate. Yeah. After the tower is up and gone, Synergy is done. They're gone. They're
right.
Gone, they're involved.
Right. Okay. Correct.
That's what you're getting at.
Yeah. Correct. Okay. So I just want to also make another comment is that, you know, earlier you mentioned that you are the representative speaking. Yes, because that's how you get paid. It's you're the guy, you're basically a broker going out there to get the locations, and if you don't get that approved, you don't get paid.
That's absolutely not true. I don't get paid anymore if I get approved versus I get denied.
Right. Okay. So I just want to say that you mentioned that you are the person that's representing, like, for example, the pastor and so forth, and I met the pastor last time, and just from my observation, it seems like he doesn't want to get involved. That was my impression, but I don't know. So I'm just kind of reinforcing what Maria said, is that we understand you were the voice for this project, but because it's really still the pastor, because the pastor and the church has the say of saying future tower, yes or no. Or yes, you know, I don't know what kind of contract you guys signed, but I guess at any point, because you know what, I changed my mind, I don't want this to be here. So for us, even though you are representing the project, but he is still the property owner, so to speak. You know, it's kind of like a solar panel company, they can't install anything unless the owner agrees. So it's important for us, and since you're kind of a company that just coming in and out, you know, the people that's going to be around are the neighbors and the pastor, and to deal with that. So I'm just kind of reiterating the importance for him to be as much involved.
When you're relating that to the upkeep of the tree, again, the upkeep of the tree is not the responsibility of the pastor or the church. It's the pole owner. The pole owner is Verizon. Mm-hmm. Verizon's responsibility is to upkeep that. How you protect against that is you put a condition of approval, recommendation, up that requires maintaining the look of the tree, and the branch density of the tree. My recommendation for branch density level is always 3.5 branches per foot. I reiterated that a couple times. That ensures a very full branch tree and a more realistic looking tree, as well as socks on the antennas.
So
socks and antennas are basically faux metal wraps that go around.
So does Verizon have a lease then with the church?
We do.
Okay. So how much is that a month? I mean, how much does he make?
It's a private matter. Yeah.
So, I mean, I know what other things are. It's just like, I totally understand when he says it's not my thing. But if he ultimately has the lease as the leaseholder, then he has a right to also... you know, demand an upkeep, and we didn't see that vigilance with that other tree.
He was actually, as I mentioned, proactive in getting that tree fixed on his own accord by contacting the Indian Crown Castle afterwards.
Okay,
I just want to make one comment. I hope all of this tonight is also, you know, sending a message to the pastor and the board that they need to be good neighbors in this community, meaning upkeep, property upkeep. This is an in-between line that message, and also maintenance of that, if approved, cell tower.
Okay. Understood.
All right.
It was actually a conversation the pastor had with Brian on the council district's office and with John and the people that were there. And he took blame and fought back. He said, you know, I can see where you're talking about saying that we're not a good neighbor with a look in the back lawn with where it's at. We kind of thought we were doing the right thing. Turns out we weren't. And we do want to be good neighbors. And so the church has been, so far, very cooperative with relocation of the tree and moving everything and getting it redesigned so that we can try and come to some kind of mutual conclusion.
The biggest thing we have to do is come up with what is the minimum, the very minimum that you would accept as far as, because I don't think you're gonna get rid of
this. We want a letter from the church that they will not put anything else on there, and that the 45 foot is the limit, that they're not gonna go to 60. So not go to 60. Two, no more towers or other buildings like that. Because in 5 years there could be something else. So this is, and then the third thing is to replace the brick wall. Because if you put lines on that thing, you know what I'm saying? It's like they
what
have.
What was the height of 45?
45 feet.
45.
So if those three things, then I.
Jill, the letter, should the letter be addressed to the neighborhood council? Because it's a public body and it's there and more.
Well, yeah,
more
since
people,
you're asking for our approval or.
Or should be adjusted?
Well, she's asking for the letter. So I'm asking her, what is she comfortable with where the letter should be addressed to?
I would enter into the record at the hearing. Fine. And then also what you can do when you do letters, like when I worked for a law firm, we used to have multiple parties on there, so it could be addressed to you, it could be addressed to John, it could be addressed to me. Mm-hmm. And then that way it can be on there. But those three things. Okay. So I don't know if you're taking notes or anything. Also, I would like for them to really consider that other fence with the other neighbor. Number one, because I think it's because there are children that play on that lot sometimes.
The fence on the northern property line or the western property line?
Because they do have children that play out there sometimes. And so, I mean, you can see here how this used to be done right here, right? But then they also have a hurricane fence here. And then you see over here, like all these are here. Like this is in the States, his children play over here. You see what I'm saying? And so that fence, I don't know if they need to, I don't know what you do, I don't know if they need to take it down, I don't know if they need to put in more. I don't know how that would work. But do you see how that fence is ready to fall over? So that's all I'm just saying, just as a neighbor. You see what I'm saying? Do you think that's a good neighbor? And he's had a couple months to fix this stuff too. So do you know what I'm saying? Like he could have fixed it, right? I just meant it's been 20 years.
Fair enough. And part of the conversation that we had with money being spent on the upkeep of the property is a lot of that money goes back to the issues and the property. And part of the conversation I had in his representation of Brian O was we plan on devoting more resources for the upkeep of the property, which they'd be using from the new cell phone.
Well, one of the other councilmen who is here, who's that gentleman? One of the council people here had researched the pastor's house. He has a very nice house out in Santa Clarita, and there's no cell towers around, like, for miles.
He gets no personal income from it.
Yeah. So, okay. Well, just so you know, just like one of the people on the council was so concerned about the neighborliness. He did research the pastor and some stuff about him.
Yeah, but those issues cannot.
I understand, but we're just talking about neighborliness, you know.
Yeah.
I'm concerned.
Okay, so.
Well, yeah, I think we have what we need, which is basically a letter from the church limiting the height and Synergy, limiting the height of.
The letter wouldn't be from Synergy.
It'll be from the church.
So three things that I want to be really clear.
And that you would agree, and the church would agree to no more co-locations.
No additional towers.
No additional towers.
No co-location to the existing facility, and no raising the height of the proposed facility.
And the brick fence.
In the brick.
All the way around. Yeah. So, and I'd really like for them to look at the other neighbor there, where the fence is going like this. He died a couple years ago, and the house isn't looking great because the daughters. I don't know what they're doing, probate or something. So that house. I don't know. It might be difficult for the be difficult to do that. I understand, but it's been like that for 20 years. That's all we're saying, and we've been looking at that for 20 years. So,
I have a procedural question.
Then what I think we're going to do is we're going to table this to the next planning and land use meeting. Rather than bring it to the board, because we still don't have that information, and the next board meeting is next Thursday.
That's my question. Mm-hmm. My concern was whether we're going to have another plan meeting before the next full neighborhood council meeting.
No.
The hearing's on 12/5. So do we have enough time to have the plan meeting and go to full neighborhood council meeting? That's my concern.
Well, how soon could you get?
We have a
problem because we have to post in a certain amount of time. For that, first thing in the morning, I can contact our attorney, city attorney, and ask him about that. But I don't know if we have enough time because we're already doing our agenda for next Thursday's board meeting.
Okay.
And
could we move the
Our meeting is Thursday.
The general
meeting is Thursday. And at that meeting, that's when things get approved or not.
Okay.
So
let me give you a date because I'm looking at a date. So 12/5 is a Friday. So 12/4
is that the first
Thursday?
Is that the first Thursday?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we would meet with the board. Oh, the hearing is on the 5th?
Mm-hmm. On the 4th.
I thought you said the 5th.
I did say
12/5. You did. It's like 12/4. So the hearing is on Friday, and our meeting is on Thursday.
Yeah. No, ours is a Thursday. The meeting.
Our board meeting is Thursday.
Okay. The meeting with the planning commission.
Yeah.
Is at 4:30 on that Thursday.
Yeah, because usually they don't have meetings on Friday.
Yeah.
So that would be before that. Yeah. So if we moved it to the January appeal meeting, would we have to do that then? It seemed pretty easy with Heather Bloomer. She just kind of.
Ms. Heather, I've got a couple more questions.
I have a suggestion.
What?
Why not just go ahead, table it, schedule another special planning and land use committee, go ahead and schedule a special board meeting. To deal with this specific issue.
I don't know if we can do that.
That's the way you can deal with it before the time period comes. Just a suggestion.
Yeah, that sounds good. The problem is we have people who are in and out of town right now. I mean, Jerry is out of town. Brad just got back in town. I can't promise anything by just sitting here and then saying, well, we can have a special meeting. I have no doubt that we could have a special meeting. But it would have to happen after our next board meeting, which still means that it won't become before our board until December.
That's why I'm suggesting you need two. You need one for the planning.
Yeah, and I'm not sure the board.
It's just a possible solution
for a special meeting to handle just this. Well,
can the full board make? I don't know the answer. Is it possible to just go straight to the neighborhood council meeting for action and to solve this?
I think we'd still have that. I'm not sure that we'd have all the information we're asking for now there. And if we didn't, then we'd be stuck with an agenda item that would waste a lot of our time when all of the information isn't there. And that's our job, is to bring that information before the neighborhood council. And I can't swear that we'd have that information. And there's no way in the world I can really jumpstart this. We're going to have a full agenda at our next
general meeting. I know that because there's a number of issues that are going to be brought up. In fact, I've already put at least 10 agenda items that's got to be brought up because they weren't brought up at the last general board meeting. So we're doing a little catch up.
If we moved it to the review meeting.
I'll check with Heather. I'll check with the city. I'll check with the city. A lot of it has to do with availability of scheduling. Sometimes it's not as easy as going to 1 month. It could potentially be 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
So I've got to check with the city, which I don't mind checking. I don't see a big issue with delaying it a month.
There you go.
Okay.
That would be fair.
That would be good.
I need to see if there was a way to do it without doing that. That's part of my job, but I don't have a problem.
Hearings can be moved up.
Yeah.
So
if the city can do that, there's no problem there.
Yeah. So either with the other stakeholders being here or with those
with those signatures,
with that letter in hand, then I would feel a lot more rounded as far as footing goes and what I can present. Right. And what we'd be a lot more confident because the last time and you guys said we supported and we didn't. We said we had no objections. And you guys went and said, we recommended. We never recommended. We said that we had no opposition if certain conditions were met.
And I thought I worded it as conditions of approval. Jill clearly states that's not what I said. That wasn't my recollection. It wasn't my intention to misrepresent anything with what the board said.
Yeah, because in situations like this, because we've been dealing with cell towers for at least 7 years.
I work with you folks all the time.
Yeah, you do.
The last thing I want is my reputation tarnished with you guys and my credibility shot. I think every time I've come before you, I was pretty upfront with my recommendations, the way I present myself, my company, and my client with what they are. And I've always tried to help with actually making sites look as good as they can with where they're at. And I think I've been pretty good about that.
Well, I can't say what people hear. You say one thing and people hear something else, and they may misinterpret it. But like I said, we seldom, if ever, give our recommendation to approve. What we usually do is, we don't have any objections because a lot of times we haven't heard from all the stakeholders in an area. And if we haven't heard from all the stakeholders, then the best thing we can do is, based on what we know, we have no opposition.
Okay, so for the record, we're going to wait for the neighbors wait to get the letter, okay? Is that about that?
Understood.
For the record.
Right, he's not with, he's just not the stakeholder.
Yeah, but he posts it, so it's on YouTube. So.
Yeah.
So after we get that with those three conditions, then I will go to the neighbors.
Okay, and we will. I will have you guys at the top of the meeting, at our next meeting. And hopefully we can move a lot faster.
What is the date of the next meeting?
The next meeting, it's always the last. It's always the last Wednesday of the month.
Okay, so it would not be the week of Thanksgiving.
Wait a minute. Oh yeah, I forgot about Thanksgiving is coming up.
So it's quite the week. So last week of Thanksgiving is on a Thursday.
Wednesday.
In November, there's four Thursdays.
Wednesday.
So it's 26th is the last Wednesday in November.
Yeah.
Okay, that's
I'm letting go away. I'm off that week, and I have plans for that week.
So we probably will do it like the 19th, right? Which is the
third. We probably move it up just because we don't
or maybe even
we don't want to clash with Thanksgiving.
Maybe
even July. I do have plans for that.
Yeah.
Because that's like a long weekend over there. People probably flying out.
Yeah.
So we might do it the 12th.
Yeah,
November 12th.
We'll probably move it up to
November 12th.
Okay, what's the following
week? Can we make sure we post it ahead of time and
too.
We've got no issues
when
from
travel,
the public?
The 27th is Thanksgiving. The
19th.
The 19th.
That's a Wednesday.
The 19th. Yeah.
Wednesday 19th. Yeah.
Yeah. That's a full week before Thanksgiving.
Perfect.
Yeah, because I don't want to have a meeting the day before Thanksgiving. It's not going to work for anybody. So we'll have it a week before, move it up, And
well, so you're thinking the 20th?
Is it the 20th?
Yeah.
Is that Wednesday? Oh, yeah, okay, it's Wednesday the 20th, yeah.
Or maybe the 13th.
No, Wednesday the 20th. We got to keep it as close to the original meeting date as possible, but Thanksgiving is probably, what, the 28th? Thanksgiving is 28th. Yeah, I don't want to have it on the 27th, so we'll move it up to the 20th.
Mm-hmm. That's not really close.
Yeah, but it's a week before Thanksgiving.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't want
to
have it.
We need to.
Who's going to travel a week before Thanksgiving?
So Wednesday the 19th will be the meeting.
Yeah, I'll be here.
Okay. Could the pastor come too?
I will invite
him. Again, he can ask him, but he can't promise.
I'm sure he'll be here.
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Okay.
And I'll ask the whole neighborhood to be here too.
So we will move this to November 20th, 13th, Wednesday. Okay.
And I just want to acknowledge you for always coming prepared with the beautiful choirs and the things.
Yeah,
so
thank you very much.
Okay. So, okay, we got to move on now.
Okay.
Pacific Plan, Commercial District.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Okay, prohibited uses. Enforcement decision of land use restrictions embodied in the Granada Hills Pacific Plan, Municipal Code, Los Angeles County, California laws, and recommendations for amendments of same. Discussions and enforcement options available to remove prohibited uses, massage parlors, unpermitted alcohol and tobacco use, and possible action to recommend enforcement of same. Okay, Maria?
Yeah, actually, we're going to be working with our senior lead officers and the new city attorneys that have, you know, the neighborhood prosecutors in Devonshire Division, and hopefully we can get a little more input as to some of the crime involved with these type of establishments. Since the specific plan is now open for revision, our design review board will also have some input into this. I brought this up at the last meeting. I think this is something we have an opportunity to look at, the kind of commercial uses that this
why
community...
Was the, one thing, uh-huh. Why was the specific plan reopened again?
No, it's reopened along with the community plan. It's not again.
Oh,
it's just
okay.
Part of the community plan process.
Yeah.
The specific plan is also being opened up for revision. So it's an opportunity to take a look. I just brought this, you can get this online here, the specific plan, and what are some of the prohibited uses like Turkish baths, drive-through restaurants that egress right onto the boulevard, auto mechanics. You know, there's reasons why some of these uses are prohibited because they do create an impact on the neighborhood. So what I like to do, and let's start moving this forward because the ball is starting to move forward on this, and I think we have some time, is take a look at some of, let's say for example, cell towers in the public right-of-way. Do we want that in the commercial district? Do we want a cell tower just right in the middle of the street? Do we want a billboard that's illegal? Do we want flashing billboards? You know, what kind of, you know, big signs do we want? What are we going to do about the illegal billboards? What are we going to do about hookah lounges? What are we going to do about massage parlors that have been such fronts for prostitution? You know,
we need to establish a position on those.
Well, yeah, I think what we need to do is let's, as a committee, start looking at these. Look at the prohibited uses that you have. Look at some other specific plans, you know, in the area in Los Angeles. See what they've done. And let's come up, you know, with some issues that would be, that we could have in writing, you know, to the city officials, you know, before this is approved, before it goes down the line. Because we have some time right now. You know, we've also had some problems with recycling. And you know, maybe we can make some provisions to make them more permanent so they're not such a fencing operation for underground operations, you know, to kind of set a little more of a standard for our community since we have
the I think limiting the number and the distance.
Well, yeah, that's it, but that could be something that we could do as well. Let's take some of these problematic uses and let's as a committee start looking at these because the ball's already rolling from other areas.
Well, I mean, we might as well get started right now. I mean, this is what the committee meeting is for.
Yeah.
Let's start with stuff like you got massage parlors down here.
Okay, but what we're gonna need from the city attorney is to articulate some type of legal language, you know, to define a massage parlor,
what's its purpose, how it's attached, you know, what the use will be, to have a clearer guideline, because right now they're very fuzzy.
Okay, now what do you mean by unpermitted alcohol in the facilities? I didn't think there was any.
Yeah, so can you, yeah.
Unpermitted, what I guess we could also look at would be establishments that can kind of cross over to illicit drug abuse. So perhaps establishments that sell drug paraphernalia, that kind of a thing. But we would have to give it the city attorney to articulate some language as to.
Okay, but drug paraphernalia doesn't necessarily mean they have anything to do with drugs, because I know a lot of these drug costs, I have some of this stuff, and it's not always, it has multiple uses. That was the problem I have, is just that some of this paraphernalia has multiple uses.
Yeah, but that's something that you might want to look into when you're drawing up commercial uses in your commercial district, because let me tell you, we've had mega crime. You know, whatever you feel about marijuana dispensaries, I mean, it brought documented crime to the area that we have documents on. I mean, we had to do stakeouts for MS-13 gang graffiti that we were personally staking out 24 hours at night, taking photos, working with the police, because the dispensaries brought in gangs, they brought in graffiti. Our billboards were completely covered with graffiti. It took years. So
yeah,
we need to take a look.
One of the problems with that was it happened so quickly that the police departments and everybody else didn't have a chance to get in front of it. Mm-hmm. It just came up. What I'm thinking right now is we need to, because I do believe that in 2016, legalization of recreational drugs, for pot, mm-hmm. I think that's going to be approved. And I think the best way to do it is try to get in front of that now by limiting what can be established here today. And like the paraphernalia, I'm not worried about the paraphernalia, because an area can only handle so much. But if you don't get ahead of those places that are not medical marijuana, because I think the medical marijuana is going to be swamped, overrun by, if it gets legalized, then you won't even have to, that big pretense of medical marijuana won't even matter, because you'll be inundated by people opening up marijuana shops, period. So what I'm saying is we need to get in front of this now and write that in to this specific plan.
You know, you might want to talk about limiting the proliferation.
Yeah.
You want to take a look at, you know, some of the kind of commercial uses that have been banned in other cities, like Google Lounges,
mm-hmm.
And such as massage parlors. You know, they're having
yep.
a terrible problem in the city of Torrance with that right now. And I've brought that up in the past.
Yep.
But, you know, let's take a look at what are some of the commercial uses that bring crime to areas, and maybe we can take a look at either, you know, limiting the proliferation of them legally, you know, so we're not violating anybody's rights, so that we have a leg to stand on, that this is something that is going to improve the community rather than tear it apart.
Yeah.
So these are some of the suggestions that have come up.
And see, I think that's probably the best way to do it, is just say, remember when we were talking about medical marijuana before, and we were talking about limiting it to how close it could be from a church, schools,
sensitive uses,
and by doing that, since we only have so many places in Granada Hills, period, where things could be sold, I mean, our business district are fairly well defined, and I think that would probably be the best way to tackle it, and put those uses, limiting those uses, so if we can't stop one from coming in, that's all we can do. We can say, okay, well, you can come in, but nobody else, because you can't be this close from schools, you can't be this close from churches, daycare centers, and so forth and so on. So it would limit it to maybe one location maybe in the city
But you won't have them right next door to one another, one after another.
There are sensitive uses all along Chatsworth. There are some little schools, there are some churches along Chatsworth. Yeah. So, you know, there are a lot of sensitive uses. So 1,000, you know, feet within a sensitive use, you're probably pretty much going to cover, you know, whatever. But anyway, so Eric, let's just start working on this. And I'm not exactly sure what kind of action you want to take on this. Let's wait for
prohibit any, you know, let's draw out what we think is a reasonable limit from sensitive locations, schools, churches, daycare centers, and so forth. And
I mean,
so
we have some time on this. This is not like we need it by next month.
No.
But I really wanted this committee to give this some thought, because, you know, our design review board is giving this some thought, and so is our neighborhood watch.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know.
And we can say this, we can extend it out and say the same thing with the hookah lounge.
Yep.
That, you know, you can't have one hookah lounge right next door to or within so many feet of another hookah lounge.
We could do that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so those uses there would be a lot stronger by limiting how many can be within a certain area.
A sensitive use. Okay, we could look at that. And we can also look at what other cities have done and what other specific plans have prohibited and what other cities have actually banned.
Yeah, because I think that would be the safest way to go.
Legally speaking.
Okay. She just went out. Her phone and everything is still here. Okay. She might have went to the bathroom.
All right.
Okay. Granada Hills Community Plan.
There's no new update on that whatsoever. So I just wrote that down as a no update.
Okay.
But it's good to kind of, you know,
keep
abreast.
Okay, community care facilities.
Community care facility ordinance. Councilmember Englander moved as an action, actually back in August, that the sunset of this committee would actually be extended to or sunset on April 30, 2015. So in other words, this committee will be extended until April 2015.
Okay.
But there haven't been any meetings, so there's nothing to update there.
Okay, the CIS small life subdivision guidelines and ordinance need to be posted.
That's just business. I just kind of wanted to bring it up so that we or you as a chair could get with the secretary or whatever just to have our CIS that we voted on and approved to have.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I've posted some of this to Brad that we have to talk about, because last month Brad thought it was just an extension of the bylaws, and I told him no. I said, you know, this stuff came from bank, and these were council files, and I said we were supposed to act on those council files, and I said you didn't agendize them, so I can't even bring them up.
But actually we did. Okay, we did make a resolution on the small subdivision.
Okay.
So that just needs to be brought up and just a secretarial follow-up on it.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what we talked about in the bank meeting, was the fact of following up.
And that
the,
too.
The guidelines
that's true.
On the we were supposed to have five members
who could be
accessed.
Doing it. Yeah.
And who would be following up on all of these council files, because council files change over time. What you voted for last time, it's somehow in committees, these things get changed around, and then the wording changed, and next thing you know, you're on the wrong side of what you wanted.
So actually, we have different ways of writing these CISs. I hope that Brad will invite, what was her name? She presented a thing. It'd be really good for her to present to our neighborhood council about the new policies. I think it's a really good way of writing a community impact statement.
Yeah.
So if she could come before the,
you know
the
what? In fact, I had asked Brad to invite Lydia.
Grant?
Not Grant, the other Lydia. I forget her name. I have her card at home. I don't have it with me. In fact, when I sent him off the agenda items I wanted to cover, it had her name on it, and I gave him her card. And she said she would be glad to come and explain the changes in doing the council files.
Yeah, I think she's the one that appeared at bank, I think.
Yeah, she was the one who appeared. And she said that she would gladly come and she would give a PowerPoint presentation so everybody would know, but we would have to designate five people who their responsibility would be
to monitor these council funds.
And Bank is Valley Alliance of Neighborhood Councils.
Yeah.
We use a lot of acronyms.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
So
that's public, just a little housekeeping.
Public comment?
Yes.
Next time you do an agenda item and you're going to put in an acronym, please spell it out. It just says CIS, and though we may know what a CIS is, the general public may not. And just as a helpful benefit along that lines, it'd be really nice if on the page for the Planning and Land Use Committee, you put up a brief description of what a CIS is supposed to accomplish and the different ways that they can be submitted, so that the public, when they come and you're talking about a CIS, or Community Impact Statement, they'll understand a little bit more about what your goal is when you talk about it.
I think the Community Impact Statement, there are some new guidelines.
And yeah, I that's what we were just talking about, having, I forget Lydia's last name, but that's why we were talking about having her come to the meeting and explain it to everybody.
I believe that was Linda Gravani.
Gravani, that's it.
From Lake Balboa. She did the presentation at North Hills West at their last meeting.
She did?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I've asked Brad Smith if he would invite her.
She's a great speaker.
Yeah.
And she would be great to have. What I'm asking, though, is that there be a brief explanation of what it is on the page for the Granada Hills South Planning and Land Use Committee, because you're going to probably be doing one of these or three of these every month from here on out. So
yeah,
just
also,
that.
Quite a few of them come from the Valley Alliance at their meetings, and they have positions, and they want us to bring them back to our council meetings and discuss them and have us take a position and then put it in our council.
Yeah, it's just kind of like a general thing. It's a new thing. It's been changed. It'd be helpful if everybody knows what they're about, so when they come up, we know that there's not just two options anymore. There's six. Which will be very helpful in something that thing was a council file.
Yeah. Well, like I said, it's why I wanted to have her invited.
She'll be more than happy to come
and explain it.
I think it's kind of good that the whole committee, all of us, watch some of these ordinances that we've been following, because you know what? Within 24 hours, all of a sudden, a new report pops up on the council file. I try to watch them as best I can, especially before the meetings, for any last-minute changes, because sometimes I'm even surprised. But, you know, it's really good for all the committee members to watch the files that we've been making positions on, because they change, they may...
I can tell you one thing. We haven't had a review of any of our community impact statements, to my knowledge. I know we've submitted a number, and we've submitted positions, but I don't remember anybody ever coming back and saying, well, this council file that we submitted to back in January... Mm-hmm. It's changed, and now it says this, this, and this, and I haven't heard anybody come back and review or give us a report on it,
yeah,
to my knowledge, for the last couple of years.
Well, that's true, because I have to tell you, most neighborhood councils and neighborhood organizations, when they make position statements, they kind of make them vague, so it's kind of a one-size-fits-all.
Yeah.
So they support the concept, but I think with the new changes in the community impact statement, the way we're going to be able to write them, we're going to be able to address the newer reports that come up on a file and be able to address that in a more effective, meaningful way. Because, you know, before the CISs were yeah, yes, or no, that kind of a thing. But I think we'll have a little more latitude now with that.
Yeah.
So I think that'll be really, really helpful. Okay. Plan Check NC, those are meetings that are held Saturdays, second Saturday of the month. We had a really fantastic meeting in October, actually, and it was conversation with the city attorney. It was in Carmentry, Michael Fuhrer's place. There was a land use attorney from the land use division, and she was wonderful. She basically was telling us about ordinances or about files and things that come before the city. But the city attorney needs to vet some of these things, you know, to make sure that they're legally binding. For example, if we have a development in the area, and we have an input to that particular property, and we feel, let's say, that something legally isn't really straight, maybe it's being rubber stamped, maybe some of the conditions or some of the specifications for a variance haven't been met by the applicant, it is up to the city attorney to take a look at that and vet that, because she was telling us, you know, we don't want legal action against the city. We want to make sure that these decisions, the neighborhood doesn't come back and sue. So she wants to, you know, she was telling us we want to make sure that these are, you know, up front in the beginning. I thought that was just an amazing tool that we have from the city, you know, is to be able to use that, to be able to access that.
Yeah.
So that was really nice. But anyway, I heard all the horror stories about the developments, you know, residential overbuilding and developments across the city. There were probably maybe 60, 50 people there. And so they had some concerns with the city attorney. And it's quite, I would say, it really takes you aback at what's going on. So this was very important. Okay, also last Saturday, I attended the Los Angeles Conservancy celebrating Los Angeles Historic Preservation Overlay Zones. Really another fascinating Saturday that I spent. This was very well attended, even though they charged $35 for the pleasure.
Really?
Yes. And actually, it was probably about 200 people there, if not more, and discussing about the process of protecting their neighborhoods, their special historical neighborhoods, the overlay districts, and that kind of a thing. Right now, there are 16 neighborhoods in the queue for HPOZ overlays, and there are now 29 HPOZs. We have an HPOZ, Granada, Balboa Highlands, the Eichler homes that were built in 1960, so that those neighbors spent years. But, you know, an HPOZ.